Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Technology Fallacy, How People Are the Real Key to Digital Transformation. By Gerald C. Kane, Nguyen Phillips, Jonathan R. Copulsky, and Garth R. Andrus. Narrated by Jack DeGolia. Introduction, Digital Disruption, The Cyclone Has Arrived. Andrew Grove, one of Intel's founders, warned years ago that only the paranoid survive. Paranoia seems well warranted at this particular point in time. Companies and entire sectors are being toppled at unprecedented rates. Fierce new competitors, using business models that were once inconceivable, owe their existence largely to rapidly evolving technology. If you're leading a well-established organization, you can't help but be concerned. After all, who wants to be the next Borders or Blockbuster? This is a book about disruption caused by technology. More specifically, it's about how to manage disruption, adapt to disruption, and thrive in a world and a time marked by disruption. But it's not about technology per se. In preparing to write this volume, we reviewed many books and articles about digital disruption. A vast body of management literature describes how technology gave rise to and continues to fuel the digital disruption phenomenon. We leave guidance about technology stacks, architectures, and roadmaps to others. We have chosen to focus instead on the organizational changes required to harness the power of technology. For ease of discussion, we simply use the term technology throughout this book to refer to various digital technologies as a group. Our focus on the people and the organizational side of digital disruption does not mean we believe that technological aspects are unimportant. On the contrary, we certainly recognize that the technological challenges facing many companies are significant. The purpose of this book, however, is simply to argue that the organizational challenges of digital disruption are on a par with the technological ones, even though they've received less attention in both literature and practice. Furthermore, while the technological challenges many companies face will vary considerably by industry and strategy, our research suggests that many companies are likely to face a common set of organizational challenges. In this book, we provide the insights necessary for leaders to navigate the journey through the strange new competitive environment wrought by digital disruption. By leaders, we mean managers at all levels in an organization who can influence how their organization works, from C-suite executives to hands-on project managers and everywhere in between. How leaders at each level adapt may differ, but adaptation at all levels is critical. C-suite executives may need to cast a bold new vision for how their organizations will adapt to a changing world. Project managers must create an operating environment that's more conducive to effective work in a digital age. Innovations can then spread across the organization as those team members experience a better way of working. Both top-down and bottom-up innovation are essential for becoming a digital organization. Executives cannot simply impose change on organizations, yet grassroots change is unlikely to be sustainable without strong executive support. As we searched for a way to frame our research insights and guidance, we found ourselves returning repeatedly to a familiar story from our childhoods, the story of the Wizard of Oz. Most of us know the 1939 MGM movie that made a star out of 16-year-old Judy Garland. The film's famous lines including, "There's no place like home," and "Toto, I've a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore," are well-known staples of popular culture. The Wizard of Oz story is the story of Dorothy, a young Kansas farm girl who, after being knocked unconscious in a cyclone that carries her house to the land of Oz, follows the yellow brick road, alongside her dog Toto, to the Emerald City to meet the Wizard of Oz. Along the way, Dorothy encounters a cast of characters, including the Scarecrow, the Tin Man, the Cowardly Lion, and the Wicked Witch of the West. The movie starts with the Cyclone, which seems like an apt metaphor for digital disruption. Dorothy didn't choose to go to Oz, but was swept up by forces beyond her control. Her world in Kansas is shown in black and white, in stark contrast to the technicolor land of Oz, where her house lands. Dorothy has no choice but to navigate this new landscape, developing new friendships and facing unfamiliar challenges to find her way home. Aspects of the Cyclone accurately characterize how many companies experience digital disruption. For most, it's a journey that companies engage in because they have no choice. They have been swept up by forces beyond their control, taken to a new world where the rules of competition seem as different as the contrast between the black and white hues of Kansas and the technicolor palette of Oz. Perhaps the most important observation about the Cyclone, however, is that the story of the Wizard of Oz isn't really about the Cyclone. Dorothy's adventures certainly would never have happened had the Cyclone not come to Kansas, but the story is more about Dorothy making her way in this strange new world than it is about how she got there in the first place. In the same way, the story of digital disruption we explore here isn't really about technology. Rather, it is about how companies navigate their way through the new competitive environment to which technology has brought us. It is about learning to do business in different ways, restructuring organizations to enable them to respond more effectively to changes brought by an increasingly digital environment, and learning to adapt individual and institutional skill development and leadership style for the demands of this rapidly changing world. This cyclone of digital disruption didn't just touch down recently. It has a long path tracking across industries and professions for decades. Although we don't know exactly the details of the next stage of digital disruption, we have no reason to believe that its impact will abate. While exploring the conditions that got us here may be instructive, the story that most listeners are concerned with is what to do once we find ourselves in this strange new world of digital disruption. The Wizard of Oz movie is based on a series of books by L. Frank Baum, beginning with The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, published in 1900. A critical difference between the movie and the book is that in the book, Dorothy realizes that she can never return permanently to Kansas and remains in Oz. Like the heroine of the book, companies can never return to the pre-digital disruption world they once inhabited. We hope that you find the metaphor useful in understanding the digital disruption challenges and opportunities organizations face. As Dorothy would say, "I've got a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore." About the research. This book is grounded in 4 years of research conducted in partnership with MIT Sloan Management Review and Deloitte into how technology changes the way companies operate. We surveyed more than 16,000 people over 4 years about their experience with digital disruption and their perceptions of the nature and adequacy of their organization's response. Although some questions remain consistent from year to year, we also asked new questions that arose from the results of the previous year's research. Each year's survey consists of between 3,700 and 4,800 responses. When discussing survey results in the book, we typically refer only to the results from a single year, but we do not specify from which year the data are drawn for ease of listening. While there may be some small shifts in the actual numbers in the data from year to year, the general relationships and key themes and takeaways have remained consistent over the 4 years we collected these data. If listeners would like to peruse the published report, they are all available online at the MIT Sloan Management Review website. The survey approach has multiple advantages. The method is familiar to the most people, can be relatively easily implemented and analyzed, can be widely disseminated, and can improve through iterations. As such, it's a good approach to studying a rapidly evolving but unevenly distributed phenomenon. Nevertheless, survey responses must be utilized carefully, since respondents' perceptions are often limited and biased. In some situations, these perceptual data are not an issue. For example, when we asked employees how long they plan to stay in their current jobs in light of digital trends, we believe the responses reliably reflected their intentions. In other cases, respondents' perceptions were more problematic. For example, when we asked respondents to evaluate the digital maturity of their organization, their perceptions may not match objective reality, since they have a limited ability to calibrate their organization to others. We highlight those limitations explicitly when we believe it is important to do so, but we make a blanket disclaimer here to call attention to the inherent limitations of survey data that persist throughout this book. Our language in every chapter reflects this cautionary use. We also conducted more sophisticated statistical analyses on our data to ensure our findings hold up under more intense scrutiny. We performed multiple regression analyses to confirm that our findings are not purely the result of some other company characteristic, such as company size or age. Additional analyses ensured that our findings are not the result of other factors, such as the specific survey instrument we used. For example, factor analysis demonstrated that respondents weren't simply rating their company high or low across the board, rather than in response to specific questions, a characteristic known as common method bias by researchers. While the results we present in this book hold up to more stringent statistical scrutiny, we present them in the simplest possible terms for ease of presentation and discussion. We also use two other types of data to augment our survey findings. First, we interviewed more than 75 thought leaders at companies like Walmart, Google, MetLife, Salesforce, Marriott, and Facebook, just to name a few. Interviews enable us to explore in greater depth how technology is changing companies, and our interviewees' experiences help us interpret the data from our surveys. We revealed the identities for some, but others asked us to mask their identities. These interviews provide context to our survey findings, help validate the insights we derive from them, and provide additional perspectives from people on the front lines of digital disruption. Second, we augment the insights of our primary research by drawing on established literature in the fields of information systems, management, marketing, psychology, and operations, to set our findings in the broader context of management science. By triangulating our data using multiple and dissimilar sources, quantitative and qualitative methods, primary and secondary data, we hope to offset the limitation of any single data source to provide a balanced, authoritative, and novel insight into the problem of how companies respond to digital disruption. We also don't want to be bound entirely by the data. Doing so would leave us with a backward-looking approach, no matter how timely, that simply describes how companies have responded. Instead, we use this data to make proactive and prescriptive recommendations on how managers should respond. We hope to balance our insights with different types of experience to provide the most holistic picture. Our author team consists of both academics researching and teaching about digital disruption for decades and consultants who have been actively working with companies to help them adapt to the challenges of digital disruption for far longer. Throughout the book, we tend to refer to our collective experience as we, even if it represents only a portion of the four-person author team. Each member of the team has contributed different expertise and experiences. For example, we rely extensively on Kane's academic research, conducted with various co-authors, to inform our findings. Likewise, Andrus is currently working actively with clients on these issues. Phillips led this research project from the Deloitte side from the beginning, so she is deeply familiar with the data and findings. Copulsky, a recently retired Deloitte principal, a widely published author, and a current faculty member at Northwestern University, sponsored this research and brings a talent for distilling complex ideas into compelling narratives. Our team worked together remarkably well in the development of this book, and we believe the whole is more than the sum of the individual contributions. Despite the individual roles played by team members, we speak with a singular voice to reflect this integrated approach to the project. By bringing together different experiential perspectives to our data, we hope to offer a clear voice, supported by research, for how companies should respond to digital disruption. In doing so, we hope to navigate between what we regard as the limitations of previous books on this theme, avoiding either an overly analytic approach that is divorced from what most companies are dealing with today, or an overly shallow, hype-driven treatment that delivers little substance with which listeners can actually do anything concrete. We hope the result is a balanced, authoritative treatment that provides leaders with actionable guidance about how to lead their organization into the future at whatever level their influence allows. What to expect? We divide this book into three different parts. In the first part, we deal with the phenomenon of digital disruption and how companies should respond. In this part, we argue that companies should think of themselves as adapting to a changing environment. Chapter 1 posits that most leaders and employees know digital disruption is happening, yet they are not acting according to that knowledge. In this book, we focus on how to respond to digital disruption versus debating whether it's occurring. In Chapter 2, we position digital disruption as being primarily about people, specifically the different rates at which individuals, organizations, and societies respond. Any efforts for organizational digital transformation, therefore, must also involve changes to how people work. In Chapter 3, we define the concept of digital as an adjective, not a noun, and introduce the key construct of our book, digital maturity. We argue that digital maturity is the goal to which most companies should aspire when trying to compete. Chapter 4 addresses the importance of business strategy for successfully navigating a competitive environment increasingly infused with technology. We introduce approaches for developing strategy in a rapidly changing environment. Chapter 5 uses the metaphor of duct tape to introduce and explain the academic concept of affordances. We discuss how affordances, a focus on what technology allows companies to do differently, is a valuable way of thinking about the strategic challenges companies face. In the second part, we deal with the implications of digital maturity on leadership, talent, and the future of work. Chapter 6 introduces the characteristics of digital leadership. Many people tend to believe that leadership is fundamentally different in a digital environment. We suggest that the basics of leadership are the same, just enacted in a different environment. In Chapter 7, we go beyond the universal basics of good management introduced in Chapter 6 to address the specific skills and capabilities unique to the digital environment. We describe what skills and capabilities are necessary for leading a digital organization and which of those are most lacking. Chapter 8 introduces the digital talent mindset. We assert that the key way employees need to respond to digital disruption is through continual learning. Employees want to develop digital skills, but organizations are not supporting their efforts. Chapter 9 shows that most companies feel like they are lacking sufficient talent to compete in a digital world. We provide strategies that organizations can follow to attract and retain these types of valuable employees. Chapter 10 focuses on the future of work. We examine what work will be like in the coming decade as a result of digital disruption. In the third part, we address the conditions for successfully adapting to digital disruption that most organizations will need to create. Skip ahead if you like, but don't quit listening before you get to this part. Chapter 11 deals with cultivating a digital environment at your company. We find that several organizational characteristics are associated with digital maturity, namely being exploratory, distributed, collaborative, agile, and data-driven. We deal with these issues in greater depth in this section. In Chapter 12, we focus on how digitally maturing companies are organized differently. We find that they are far more likely to rely on cross-functional teams and push decision-making to lower levels of the organization. This organizational structure helps the organization respond to changes more quickly. Chapter 13 addresses how digitally maturing companies are more intentionally collaborative. We explore the benefits of technology to enable stronger collaboration, but also how these tools must be used intentionally, lest they actually lead to inferior outcomes. Chapter 14 focuses on how companies can cultivate a more experimental mindset. In a changing digital environment, companies should experiment and iterate. But these values are directly in contrast with many of those that have defined companies for most of the last 50 years. In Chapter 15, we provide practical guidance to begin making your company more digitally mature. We suggest an approach for measuring digital maturity in your organization and for moving forward toward maturity. Part 1. Navigating Digital Disruption. 1. Digital disruption is no secret. We set aside our temptation to open this chapter with a compelling case for why organizations need to urgently adapt to the disruptions wrought by technology. Why? Because, as Canadian singer-songwriter Leonard Cohen writes, everybody knows, that's the way it goes, everybody knows. You may have witnessed firsthand the destruction of the newspaper, recorded music, and photographic film industries during the first wave of technology that began nearly two decades ago. You likely know that similar disruptions are currently underway in the hotel, taxi, and retail industries as the digital cyclone continues to reshape the business landscape through companies like Uber, Airbnb, and the omnibusiness behemoth Amazon. You also know that digital disruption is far from over, as analytics and data science come into their prime, and other technologies such as artificial intelligence, blockchain, virtual and augmented reality, and autonomous vehicles loom on the horizon. You know that more businesses and entire sectors will certainly topple, with new, nimble competitors scooping up current customers and bringing new customers into the fold. Our survey confirms our assertion that everybody knows that digital disruption is real and happening now. When we asked survey respondents, "To what extent do you believe that digital technologies will disrupt your industry?" 87% replied that these technologies would disrupt their industries to a great or moderate extent. Only 3% of respondents believed that technology is likely to have no effect on their industry. We didn't ask this 3% when was the last time they had read a hard copy newspaper, visited a record store, or booked a trip through a personal travel agent. Most respondents also recognized the need for organizations to adapt effectively to these changes as an important factor for success and survival in the coming years. 84% of our respondents agreed, or strongly agreed, that becoming a digital business is important to their organization's success. So, let us stipulate from the outset that digital disruption is happening and will likely affect your industry. Precisely when and how that disruption will happen may differ, but most of us can agree that it's happening in some way and to some level. Such stipulation allows us to turn our attention to where it really matters. What to do now that it is happening? The gap between knowledge and action. Knowing digital disruption is happening and doing something about it are entirely different matters. The philosopher William James noted, "Thinking is for doing," meaning that the purpose of knowing things is to act in accordance with that knowledge. You might expect, consequently, that every organization has a well-developed strategy and action plan for responding to these disruptions. But the reality is quite different. Just as homeowners in hurricane or cyclone-prone areas often seem caught off guard when the actual storm strikes. We asked survey respondents whether their companies were adequately preparing for the digital disruptions most likely to occur in their industries. 44% said their companies are doing enough, 31% said their companies aren't doing enough, and 25% neither agreed nor disagreed that their companies are doing enough. The gap between the 87% who said digital disruption will affect their industry and the 44% who said their company is doing enough is, in a word, staggering. Everybody, well, almost everybody, knows digital disruption is happening. Yet only a minority report that their organizations are doing enough to respond effectively. Interpreting survey data. These survey responses exhibit many nuances that merit discussion. Perhaps our average survey respondent does not actually know how much response to this disruption is adequate. Given the uncertainty regarding the rate and scope of change from digital disruption, predicting how much an industry is disrupted, when that disruption will happen, and what will be the appropriate response can be extremely difficult even for industry experts, let alone the average employee who responded to our survey. Yet, this data should not be dismissed entirely simply because of this limitation. In many ways, employees may actually be better suited to know if an organization is responding adequately because they have firsthand experience about how these responses play out in interactions with customers, suppliers, and colleagues. As we assemble these disparate responses into a coherent data set, employees of various ages with different backgrounds and skill sets may have a more complete understanding of what may be possible with technology and could actually provide a better idea of what constitutes an adequate response than would the average C-suite executive. Executives often have a more rarefied and rosy view. In fact, our survey data consistently demonstrate that C-level and board-level respondents tend to report a far more optimistic view of their company on important issues than do respondents ranked lower in their company. Setting aside the difficulties of determining whether our survey respondents know what constitutes an adequate response to digital disruption, this type of perceptual data can become a self-fulfilling prophecy in certain cases. Whether employees know what an adequate response to digital disruption is may not really matter. If your employees don't believe that your organization is doing enough to respond to digital trends, they may start acting in accordance with those beliefs. Those employees with desirable skills may leave their jobs to join companies they believe are responding adequately. In fact, this trend is occurring, a topic we deal with in greater depth in Chapter 9. Perceptions matter because employees act on their perceptions. If employees perceive that their employers are not doing enough to respond to digital disruption, they may leave, and companies may find themselves with insufficient talent to respond adequately when the time comes. Whether your organization's leaders believe they are doing enough to respond to digital disruption may be immaterial. It may even be immaterial if the organization is, in fact, doing enough. What your employees think is happening, and whether they believe it is adequate, may matter most. This insight provides an important takeaway for managers. Because we all know that digital disruption is happening, an effective organizational response to that disruption needs to involve both talk and action. If companies simply talk about being a digital company, but don't back up that talk with concrete behaviors, employees will notice the discrepancy and respond accordingly. Likewise, an organization taking active steps to respond to digital disruption in some secret or remote innovation lab without communicating those initiatives to employees or involving them may also be problematic. An effective response to digital disruption must involve all aspects of the organization and both concrete action and clear communication regarding how the organization is changing. Why aren't companies acting? Why aren't companies responding with greater urgency to the threat of digital disruption? Executives may not understand enough about technology to make the changes or to understand the urgency necessary. Board members and investors may care more about short-term profits than the long-term viability of the company. Many leaders may be just counting down the years to retirement, and thus they don't have the energy or the interest to engage in the types of changes necessary to adapt the company for a future in which they will not participate. While any of these scenarios may be true, the most common reason we encounter is that companies are simply trying to balance too many competing priorities. It's difficult to keep the current business running while also preparing it for a digital future. Our data rule out one possible explanation for companies' lack of responsiveness. We wondered whether some executives just didn't think digital business was important for their organizations or industry's future. Might digital disruption affect the industry but not a particular company in it? When we asked whether being a digital business was important to the success of respondents' organizations, a whopping 85% either agreed or strongly agreed that it was. Even though their organizations still weren't doing enough to respond, the vast majority of respondents recognized that digital business was critical to their future. The gap between knowing about a need and taking action on that need is a well-documented phenomenon not confined to digital disruption. Jeffrey Pfeffer and Robert I. Sutton described the knowing-doing gap in a Harvard Business School Press book in 1999. As they write in their book's first chapter, why do so much education and training, management consulting, and business research, and so many books and articles produce so little change in what managers and organizations actually do? They assert that the first step in resolving the gap is focusing on why before how. They argue that too many managers want to learn how in terms of detailed practices and behaviors and techniques, rather than why in terms of philosophy and general guidance for action. Why respond to digital disruption? Put simply, the emergence of new classes of technology such as social media, mobile technologies, big data analytics, artificial intelligence, blockchain, additive manufacturing, autonomous vehicles, and augmented and virtual reality change what is possible for business. Leaders who want to maintain advantage, discover new opportunities, and better serve their customers will leverage the opportunities provided by these technologies to do business differently. Yet, leveraging these technologies amid a rapidly evolving digital infrastructure requires some fundamental shifts in how companies are organized. This book provides the tools to meet these goals. Competency traps. What got you here won't get you there. Established companies in particular typically face significant challenges from digital transformation. One of the biggest is their past success. This is often referred to in the management literature as a competency trap. Competency traps are beliefs that the factors of past success will also lead to future success. Technology is changing the competitive landscape, providing new ways of delivering value to customers and new service opportunities. And past success factors may not be associated with future success. If companies don't change their processes and mindsets to take advantage of new opportunities for doing business made possible through emerging digital infrastructure, then established or new competitors likely will. GE is one example of a company seeking to overcome competency traps. In the 1990s, GE became known for its adherence to a process known as Six Sigma, a set of techniques for reducing the error rate in manufacturing processes to 0.00033%. Six Sigma was a key factor associated with GE's success during the 1990s and early 2000s. Six Sigma, however, also has its limitations. It tends to be exceedingly difficult, if not impossible, to maintain Six Sigma standards while also experimenting with new ways of doing business. The process is not conducive to the types of agile responses to environmental shifts that characterize the world of digital business. To address the need for faster change and agility, GE has developed a complementary approach known as FastWorks, which combines lean startup principles, created by Eric Ries, with GE's size and resources. But, as GE's culture transformation leader Janice Semper remarks, it's been harder in some of our businesses where they don't have as much volatility or disruption yet. They don't necessarily feel the same need as those parts of our business that are being disrupted or are in extremely challenging, volatile, ambiguous environments where this is really the only way to go forward and work. Semper described two other interventions introduced to accelerate changes to the legacy company. First, GE leaders introduced new company values, which are customers determine our success, stay lean to go fast, learn and adapt to win, empower and inspire each other, and deliver results in an uncertain world. Second, they redesigned the performance management system. We moved away from our annual traditional performance management process to a more continuous and fluid system that is in sync with the FastWorks way of working and with the GE beliefs mindset. We have met the enemy, and he is us. Another key reason for the disparity between awareness of and action on digital disruption is that many executives simply don't understand how quickly this threat may emerge. Many are waiting to see evidence for this disruption in their organization's bottom line before acting. By the time that evidence appears, however, it may be too late. Lagging indicators are not effective tools for identifying and assessing looming threats. For example, profits in the newspaper industry grew steadily, well into the dot-com boom, at which point the profits fell off a cliff. Executives need early warning systems, particularly since many may overestimate their ability to respond in time, thinking they can just run out and invest heavily in technology when the threats manifest. Many of the leaders we interviewed from companies putting the most effort into digital transformation today are privately wondering if they may have already waited too long. We have seen a significant increase in the number of legacy companies beginning to place significant emphasis on their digital efforts. Although only a minority of respondents said that their organizations viewed digital trends as a threat as opposed to an opportunity, we asked them about the specific nature of the threat their companies faced as a result of digital trends. Instead of providing a selection of response choices, we asked them to use their own words in an open text response. Our research team then coded all 3,300 free responses into larger categories. The biggest threat that respondents reported falls under internal organizational issues such as complacency, inflexible culture, and lack of agility. In other words, the biggest threat of digital disruption is in the organization itself, that the company would be either unable or unwilling to change fast enough to respond to the threats posed by digital disruption. The cartoonist Walt Kelly created a memorable character, Pogo, a lovable swamp-dwelling possum. In 1970, in the early days of the environmental movement, Kelly inked a cartoon for the first ever Earth Day, featuring Pogo and a fellow swamp dweller surveying a litter-filled swamp. Pogo's observation could easily apply to the sentiments of our respondents. We have met the enemy, and he is us. The next biggest threats identified are market disruption, such as product obsolescence or lower barriers to entry, followed by increased competitive pressure from either new or established competitors. Taken together, these responses suggest a consistent story of digital disruption increasing the competitive pressure on organizations, and a concern that those organizations will be unable to act quickly or adequately enough to respond to those competitive changes. To us, these sound like genuine threats to which organizations should be prepared to respond. How is digital business different? We asked respondents to our survey how digital business differed from more traditional ways of doing business. This was another open text response where we gave respondents a blank text box to respond to the question in whatever way they wanted to. Members of our team then read through all 2,362 of these responses, categorizing responses into groups of similar responses. The biggest difference, respondents said, is the pace of doing business. Put simply, digital business requires companies to act and respond faster than they ever have before. The challenge is that many of the organization's communication and decision-making structures can't move as quickly as the organization needs them to. An executive we interviewed says, "It's the speed at which the landscape is changing through digital, allowing new competitors to play, that makes it really transformative. Not only is technology making industries work faster and more efficiently, we all have access to the same technology. It's the entrance of new competitors that we would have never thought of before that's throwing everyone a huge curveball." The pace of change associated with digital business is a key theme that pervades this book. The second most common difference is mindset and culture. These responses centered on the need for changes to organizational culture, but descriptions of these changes were not entirely positive. Respondents said that these cultural shifts create tensions with employees who have a more traditional mindset. In other words, competency traps may exist at the individual level, especially for established companies. Employees who have had success with a particular way of working in the past may be reluctant to change those ways of working for the future. We deal with culture in Chapter 11. The third most common difference respondents describe relates to organizational structure, the need for a flexible, distributed workplace. Part of this is about collaboration, how decisions are made, and how teams are organized. But this is also about rethinking teams and talent. Melissa Valentine of Stanford says, "It seems pretty clear that the boundary of the firm is changing in significant ways. We hear the core-periphery idea a lot here in Silicon Valley." In that model, a company relies on a group of core employees which the company plans to invest in and nurture, while tactically leveraging networks of external on-demand talent. Valentine notes that even large companies may consist of a core team and then peripheral employees and projects around it, instead of full-time employees working for a single company. For some organizations, this model may require a new perspective on how to blend full-time employees with talent sourced from the open market. Recent studies find that employers expect to dramatically increase their dependence on contract, freelance, and gig workers over the next few years. We deal with this topic in greater depth in Chapter 12. Finally, the fourth most cited difference was productivity, which can be a double-edged sword. According to John Hagel, co-chair of Deloitte's Center for the Edge, "If you're truly going to accelerate performance improvement, you have to stop focusing on efficiency. If it's just efficiency, that's a diminishing returns game. The more cost-effective and faster you are, the harder it's going to be to get to that next level of efficiency. But if you focus on effectiveness, on impact, on value delivered to whatever the arena is, the sky's the limit. That's a mindset shift. getting out of that efficiency mindset. Disruption is here, it's just unevenly distributed. The science fiction writer William Gibson is quoted as having noted, "The future is here, it's just unevenly distributed." Likewise, while we all know digital disruption is happening, the current state is unevenly distributed across industries. We deal with the specific import of these questions later in the book, but at this point, the pattern of responses is helpful. We rank industries by answers to several questions that we find are key correlates with digital maturity. The results show that many of the usual suspects are clear leaders when it comes to digital maturity: technology, telecommunications, and media. On the other hand, we were somewhat surprised to discover that no industry emerges as a clear loser. No industry ranks in the bottom five across all questions. The construction and real estate sector, for example, ranks lowest in terms of digital maturity, defined as an organization where digital has transformed processes, talent engagement, and business models, but ranks in the top five industries reaping digital gains by improving work with partners and employees. Companies in this sector also lag in the development of digital strategies focused on transforming their businesses. Consumer goods companies sit squarely in the middle of the digital maturity spectrum, but fall short on digitally enabling employees. The lesson here is that while certain industries are clear leaders and can serve as aspirational models for other industries, no industry is without hope. Each likely has some strengths to build on to begin to take their companies into a digital future. You're never too old to adapt, individually or organizationally. If learning and adapting is at the heart of tackling digital disruption, what does that mean for older companies and individuals who have been doing things the same way for years? The old adage, "You can't teach an old dog new tricks," refers to the widespread perception that as people and organizations age, they tend to be more fixed and set in their ways. Indeed, we are amazed that children pick up languages so easily while otherwise intelligent adults struggle. Look at startups, often seen as digital role models. The image of the startup is an organization that is more agile and learns and adapts more quickly than established organizations. They are also seen as being more innovative and creative. Like children, their organizational brains are more flexible and therefore have tremendous ability to learn. But over time, organizations tend to produce the equivalent of the chemical inhibitors that keep adults from learning. Instead, they tend to focus on what they already know and what has led to their history of success, to take action and to get things done. They focus on productivity and efficiency rather than learning, growth, and innovation. The key for older legacy organizations is to identify and work around the organizational inhibitors that keep them from learning and to foster a culture of learning and a growth mindset in the organization, something we address in Part 2. Digital transformation at John Hancock. A good example of an established company beginning to make the necessary changes to adapt to a digital world is the financial services firm John Hancock. The company's leadership realized that its business and organization needed to be refreshed for the 21st century and better compete in a digital world. Barbara Goose, Senior VP and Chief Marketing Officer, wanted the company to become more innovative, more entrepreneurial, faster moving, more empowered, and more collaborative. To do so, she first needed to give the people tasked with the change the freedom to work outside the traditional bureaucratic structures that define many legacy companies. Innovation teams need to be isolated and protected, to be freed from the corporate shackles in some ways, to be able to innovate and progress faster, said Goose. Digital transformation can't just be a top-down mandate to change. Instead, it involves creating the conditions in which existing employees start thinking and working differently, driving change from the bottom up as well. VP of Digital Strategy Lindsay Sutton notes, "At the end of the day, so much is about talent. Talent is two-pronged, by skill set and by attitude. That's what you need to drive an organization forward into an era they are primed to be a part of. Attitude is the one thing we sometimes forget. With the right attitude, people can develop the skills they need to work and learn in the fast-moving and ambiguous conditions that are at the heart of digital business. People with that mentality are everywhere. Some of them need to just be reminded that they can be that person." The executives at John Hancock see the competitive landscape shifting, are trying to create new competencies for competing in a digital world, and are trying to reshape how their employees work, think, and learn. Yet, driving the need for change can be difficult when established companies are performing well. Goose notes, "It's hard to drive change when people feel that the company has been successful doing everything the way it always has." She continues, "In looking toward the future, they can see that the world and customer needs are changing. We need to evolve and experience a revolution to get to a very different place as fast as we can, but it's hard to do that quickly in such a big company." Takeaways for Chapter 1. What we know. 1. Everyone recognizes that digital disruption is happening, but most companies are not doing enough in response. 1A. 87% of respondents indicate that their industry is likely to be disrupted by digital trends. 1B. But only 44% reported their organization is doing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.